each and every single Saturday evening. We're going to have a themed series concerning the major events, or some of the major events that took place during the life of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As I mentioned in my short mid-taraweeh reminder, one of the things that Ramadan encourages us to do is to look at the very many opportunities that we have at our disposal to earn good deeds and to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to take and pick some of them to benefit ourselves and to earn good deeds. From amongst those opportunities that we have available to us during this month is to come closer to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by learning about him, by spending some time, and it doesn't necessarily have to be every day or every other day, but even once or twice a week, that we spend some time and some effort learning about the life of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the lessons that we can take from his life, the lessons that we can take from the many events that occurred during his lifetime alayhi salatu wassalam. So with that in mind, we have a number of lectures planned for you inshallah ta'ala in this month of Ramadan, every single Saturday after Salat Taraweeh. The first of those lectures tonight is concerning a major event that took place in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It is an event that you've heard of many times. It is an event that Allah Azza wa Jal himself refers to in the Quran, and that is the Isra and the Mi'raj, what is often termed in the English language as the night journey. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to this journey in the Quran, and he says at the beginning of Surah Al-Isra, verse number 1, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. Glory be to the one, exalted is he subhanahu wa ta'ala, who took his slave, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on a night journey from al-Masjid al-Haram to al-Masjid al-Aqsa, the surroundings of which we have blessed. When you look throughout the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to this land many a time, the land of al-Masjid al-Aqsa, what we would call today in our modern vernacular the city of Jerusalem. This area and the surrounding areas where the masjid is, it is a blessed land, one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to not by name but by description many times in the Quran. It is the place where many of our prophets that we find mentioned, whose names are mentioned in the Quran, many of them came from, or many of them lived at one time or another during their lifetimes. They resided in this area of al-Masjid al-Aqsa. In the hadith of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, أَيُّ مَسْجِدٍ وُضِعَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَوَّلٍ. Which was the first mosque to be built upon earth, O Messenger of Allah? He said, Al-Masjid al-Haram, the Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, the Kaaba. And then he asked, radiyallahu an, thumma ay, and then which one came after this? He said, Al-Masjid al-Aqsa, Masjid al-Aqsa. So he asked, wa kam baynahuma, and what was the time frame between the two masjids being built? Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, Masjid al-Aqsa in Al-Quds. What was the time frame between the two? What was the distance, the time span in years between the construction of the two? And our Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 40 sana, 40 years. Many of the scholars, when they came to this hadith, they said that this hadith refers to its initial construction, which was in the time of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. The Adam alayhi salam built the Kaaba, but Jibreel alayhi salam came and told him the place where the Kaaba should be. And then he or one of his sons, the scholars differ and there are different narrations, but either way, he went to then Jerusalem and he built that second mosque, Al-Masjid al-Aqsa. It was then later destroyed when the floods, both of those masjids were destroyed when the floods of Nuh alayhi salam came across the earth. And then it was Abu al-Anbiya, the father of all prophets, Ibrahim alayhi salam, who would come and he would raise the foundation of those two masjids once again. One with his son Ismail in Mecca, and the other with his son Ishaq in Al-Quds. Allah Azza wa Jalla refers to, in the portion that we recited today in Surah Al-Baqarah, he refers to the raising of the foundation of the Kaaba. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. And remember, when Ibrahim alayhi salam raised the foundations of the house, meaning the foundations were already there. He raised the foundation. He would raise that foundation, and then he would raise the foundation of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, and after that many prophets of Allah would come and they would reside in that area. many of the names that we're familiar with. So the sons of Ibrahim alayhi salam himself, Ishaq, Yaqub, Yusuf, and many of the other prophets who came after them as well. Musa alayhi salam, Isa, Yahya, Zakaria, the story of Maryam, Lut alayhi salam, Dawood, Sulaiman, all of these prophets of Allah, Uzair, all of them are mentioned in the context of this land. So when Allah Azza wa Jal describes this land in the Quran, He describes it not by name but by description. And He describes it in two ways. The first is that it is Ardun Mubarak. It is a blessed land. And the word blessing or barakah in our language means an increase in good. When Allah gives you barakah, He increases you in something in a good way. Not just an increase for the sake of increase or an increase which becomes a problem for you, but it is an increase that is good for you. That is the first description that is given to this area of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in the Quran. The second description that is given is that it is a holy land. Ardul Muqaddasa. In the story of Musa alayhi salam, Ya qawmi dhkhulul arda al-muqaddasa. O my people, enter into the holy land. So it is a place that is holy, meaning that it is pure, meaning that Allah Azza wa Jal has raised its status. And we know from our sunnah that our Prophet told us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if you want to make a religious journey, a journey in order to seek reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where the ending, the destination is a place of reward, there are only three places that you're allowed to visit with that intention. Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, the Prophet's Mosque alayhi salatu wasalam in Medina, and al-Masjid al-Aqsa. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He refers to this place many a time in the Quran. And it is significant, because the story that we're going across tonight, the story of Isra and Mi'raj, revolves around this area of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. And one of the things that we should do, because it is part of our tradition and our heritage and our religion, is that we need to familiarize ourselves with Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. There are many misnomers and many misconceptions regarding this place. For example, from amongst one of them is most of us probably don't even know what Masjid Al-Aqsa refers to. Which is Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa? Some people think it's the Dome of the Rock. Some people think it's the other masjid with the black dome. You have people that think that one is Masjid Al-Aqsa and the other is Masjid Al-Aqsa. Whereas in reality, both of them and the whole surrounding area, that complex where you have the walls surrounding it, all of that is Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. And there is much history to go through, and perhaps inshallah on another occasion we can do that. But the point is that this is a place that is blessed, that Allah has blessed in the Quran. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, following in the line of his forefathers and all of his brother prophets who came before him and those messengers who came throughout the ages, Allah Azza wa Jal would give him the opportunity also to combine between these two blessed places, Mecca and Al-Quds, Masjid Al-Haram and Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before the Hijrah, in approximately the 10th year of the prophethood, in the years of Mecca before the migration to Medina, a number of events took place that would then lead up to Al-Isra and Mi'raj. And the reason why I'm giving you this background is because there is a very important lesson for us. We, many of us, are living in a time, and we live in a time, not many of us, all of us live in a time of trial and difficulty and hardship. Be that hardship in personal circumstances with our family and relatives and health and wealth and so many other issues, or be that as a community with the onslaught that we face because of the actions, unfortunately, of a few silly individuals. But all of us have to bear with that pressure. Many challenges and hardships that we face. But one of the things that we learn from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that our challenges and our hardships and our trials pale in significance to what he had to go through sallallahu alayhi wasallam, through what the companions had to suffer through radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. We have nothing compared to the difficulties that they had to go through. And so sometimes when you read the seerah, you actually understand that it is from the sunnah of Allah that even the most beloved of people to the Prophet, to Allah Azza wa Jal, and the best of this creation, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, would have to undergo trial and difficulty. So if anyone was to be saved from hardship and difficulty and trial, it would have been the prophets of Allah. But the fact that they had to undergo not only a normal average trial, but the most difficult trials imaginable, shows you that it is a way that Allah Azza wa Jal sees what a person is worth. He sees their true value. And it is a way and a means by which a person can come closer to Allah Azza wa Jal if they understand how to use that as a means of nearness and drawing closer to Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, therefore, before the Isra and Mi'raj, a number of events took place. The first of them was that his wife Khadija radiallahu anha passed away. She was the closest person to him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was his supporter, his defender. She was the one who would advise him and console him. And she was the one who would be his bedrock of strength. She passed away radiallahu anha. And very shortly afterwards, a second incident took place. And that is that Abu Talib, his uncle, also passed away. A couple of months in between the two deaths. Abu Talib, as we know, was his public defender after Allah Azza wa Jal. He was the one who would defend him against the oppression of Quraysh. He would keep them at bay. He would ward off their evil intentions from him by the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. But he too would pass away. And with the passing of these two people, the oppression of Quraysh increased not only against the Muslims, which was big anyway, but especially to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam personally as well. The third incident that took place then is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam decided that he would have to leave Mecca, that he would have to find a refuge and a shelter and a place of asylum for the Muslims outside of Mecca. Their torture and their evil was becoming too much to bear. So he went to a place called Taif. And you all know the story that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam isn't even able to spread to them the message of Islam, but instead he's exiled from the city with stones and pebbles to the extent that he is bleeding alayhi salatu wassalam. All of these events take place very close together, and they are the build-up to what would be this amazing, miraculous journey. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the greatest lessons of this whole journey, and it is a lesson that all of us should take to heart and benefit from, is that Allah azza wa jalla is showing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he doesn't need Khadija radiallahu anha. He doesn't need his uncle Abu Talib. He doesn't need all of the people of At-Ta'if. He doesn't need his companions or anyone else, so long as Allah Azza wa Jalla is with him. And with him is his divine care and protection. Whereas if Allah Azza wa Jalla was to forsake and leave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then even if Khadija was still alive and Abu Talib and all of the people of Taif and Mecca and Medina and all of the Arabs and so on and so forth, all of them came and surrounded and supported the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there would be no benefit to this support without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jal was showing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and by extension me and you, that no matter how difficult your situation is, so long as you, through that difficulty and hardship, attach yourself to Allah, come closer to Allah, become a better person in the sight of Allah, show Allah Azza wa Jal your true iman, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is enough for you against all of creation. Whereas if you forsake Allah and you turn away from Allah and you despair from Allah Azza wa Jal in the hopes of seeking the pleasure and acceptance of all of mankind, then that won't benefit you in anything. So Allah Azza wa Jal gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this lesson, not only as a verse of the Quran, not only as inspiration or revelation from Jibreel alayhi salam, but he allowed him to live it, live the lesson in this amazing journey. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam one night was by the Kaaba and he was sleeping in the Hatim area, what we call the Hijr of Ismail, that semicircle outside of the Kaaba, which is technically part of the Kaaba, but the Quraysh, when they built the Kaaba, they didn't add it to it because of the issue that they had at that time. The point being, he was sleeping there. Jibreel alayhi salam came to him and he woke him up and he took him on this journey. This journey is called as Isra and Mi'raj. It is of two parts. The first is Al-Isra, which refers to the night journey from Mecca to Jerusalem. And the second is Mi'raj, which refers to the journey to the heavens to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was presented by Jibreel alayhi salam with an animal, a riding beast that we call Buraq, or that is called Buraq. This animal Buraq, you know, contrary to what many people think of when they hear the word Buraq, it's not a horse with flying wings, and it's not one of those fantasies that you see that people have dreamt up, unfortunately. I don't know of any authentic hadith that describes it in this way. But what we do know is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described it as an animal bigger than a mule and smaller than a horse in terms of its stature. But the Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam that a single step of Buraq would go as far as the eye can see. So this was an animal that Allah Azza wa Jal has given to it, that ability and that power, that with every step and stride that it takes, it goes as far as the eye can see. So if you can imagine, in the open desert, that is a very, very long way. So within a short amount of time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able to go from Mecca to Jerusalem. This is a journey not only of spirit and soul, but it is one of body as well. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. And again, without going through the elaborate history of this place, at that time it was a place of ruin. There was no masjid, there was no Dome of the Rock. All of that was done after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was no temple, there was nothing. It was a ruin because the Roman Byzantines who had conquered that area and were the rulers of the area had demolished that area. They didn't accept it, they didn't like it. They demolished the whole thing and it was a place of ruin. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with Jibreel alayhi salam and he stood there. And one of the things that Allah azza wa jal gave to him to show him his station, to show him his stature, and we too should be proud and thank Allah Azza wa Jal for the blessing that we are from the Ummah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that he made him the Imam for all of the Prophets. All of the Prophets were gathered there. And I don't just mean the 25 odd that are mentioned by name in the Quran, but every Prophet of Allah that came from Adam alayhi salam to our own Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know from other narrations in the Sunnah that the Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they were over 124,000 in number. The vast majority of them, we don't know their name and we don't know their story. But there were over 124,000 that were sent to the different nations and peoples of the world at different times. All of them were gathered. One narration says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam felt shy, that he should go and stand in front of all of these prophets and be their imam. So Jibreel alayhi salam took him by the hand and he brought him forward to show him that no, this is your place. It is your place that you should be the imam and lead them in salah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam led them in salah. He would then go upon the second part of this journey and that is the mi'raj. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ascended to the heavens. At each heaven he was with Jibreel alayhi salam and each time they would knock and seek permission to enter. And the gatekeeper of that heaven would ask, who is this? And Jibreel alayhi salam would reply, it is Jibreel. And he would ask him, and who is with you? And he would reply, it is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it is Muhammad. And he would say, has his time come? Meaning the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he would reply, yes. And the gate would be opened and he would be welcomed into that heaven. On each one of those seven heavens, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would meet a Prophet of Allah. The first Prophet of Allah that he would meet is Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. He met the Prophet Adam alayhi salam, who welcomed him not only as a prophet, but also as a son. Because obviously he is all of our father, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. He then went on to the second and the third, and he met Yahya and Isa alayhi salam, and Yusuf and Idris and Harun and Musa. And on the seventh heaven, he met Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Each one of those prophets would welcome him, and they would welcome him as he entered into that heaven and he would speak to them. At the seventh heaven, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was then taken to a place that is described in the Quran. It is mentioned by name and it is the Sidratul Muntaha, the lot tree, as it is commonly translated into English. The lot tree, the Sidratul Muntaha. This lot tree is the point at which Jibreel alayhi salam said to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I can no longer go past this point. I can no longer accompany you. I can't go beyond this point. It is for you to now go on your own. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued on his own. And you can imagine how much from this journey Allah azza wa jalla is showing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the care and the love and the protection that he has for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah azza wa jalla has promised that same or a similar type of care and protection for the believers when they follow the path of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went ahead, and that is where he spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah azza wa jal and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked in another hadith. He was said, O Messenger of Allah, did you see Allah on that night when you went to the Sidrat al-Muntaha? Did you see Allah? And he replied sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Nurun anna ara. It was light, how could I possibly see him? Meaning the light was so bright and so amazing and so strong that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could not see past it or beyond it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then spoke directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is at that time that Allah azza wa jal obligated upon this ummah 50 salahs, 50 prayers per day and per night. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is an amazing part of this journey, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam accepted the 50 and he left. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't argue, he didn't say anything, he didn't respond, he didn't say, oh Allah. No, he accepted 50 for his ummah and he left. Which would have meant that me and you and every other Muslim, we would be praying every 30 minutes. Every 30 minutes, less than 30 minutes, we would be praying a salah. So you can imagine with your wudu and your sunnahs and everything else that you have to do for the 5 daily prayers that we find so difficult and long, and we would have had to do that every half an hour or less, because every time you finish your salah, you need to go make wudu again. The next one's coming. And if you're going to pray in jama'ah in the masjid, you may as well become a monk and live here, because you'd never leave, because that would be the reality. Allah Azza wa Jal, this is what He obligated upon us. 50 salahs every day and every night. This lecture right now would be too long. I'd have to finish because it would be salah. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal placed upon us as an ummah. The Prophet ﷺ accepted and he left and he returned. It was the Prophet Musa alayhi salam who saw the Prophet ﷺ returning and he said, what did your Lord command you with? And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam replied and he said, he ordered me that we have to pray 50 times a day and night. In a 24-hour cycle, 50 salawat. The Prophet Musa alayhi salam said to him, your people won't be able to do so. Bani Israel, my nation, meaning Musa alayhi salam, his people, who had suffered, as we know in the Quran, generations of bondage and slavery and torture at the hands of the pharaohs, and that had made them stronger, and they had made them people who could, you know, at least like physically become stronger and so on. He said, even my people would never have been able to do 50. So go back and ask Allah for a concession. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned and he asked Allah for a concession. And the concession was what? 45. 45. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, again, his humility, his humbleness before Allah, his respect before his creator, doesn't argue, accepts this is the command of Allah. We submit. Because had Allah said 50, we would have had no choice. We would have to submit. So 45, and he goes back. Musa alayhi salam stops him again. What did Allah say? He said 45. Still too much, go back. So he goes back and he becomes 40. And in increments of 5, it decreases. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is going back and forth between Allah azza wa jal and the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, until it comes down to 5. Prophet Musa alayhi salam says, what did Allah say to you? 5 prayers a day and night. What did Musa alayhi salam say? Go back, your people won't be able to do so. And how well did Musa alayhi salam know us? How well did he know the Muslims, that the vast majority, unfortunately many of them, wouldn't be able to pray 5 salahs a day and night? They would struggle. It would be difficult for them. Go back and ask Allah for less. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, as Allah had decreed for him to say, that I can no longer go back. I have been back too many times. I am too shy and embarrassed that I should ask Allah for another concession. And that is when Nada Munadin, a caller called out in the heavens and said that it was always decreed that it would be 5, but the reward would be of 50. This is the only pillar of Islam that was obligated upon the Muslims before the migration of Medina. It came before fasting in Ramadan. It came before the zakah. It came well before, many years before the Hajj. It was the first pillar of Islam after La ilaha illallah to become obligated upon the Muslims. And its manner of obligation, the way that it was legislated, is not in the verse of a Quran, even though the Quran will say the same thing later. And it is not in a visit of Jibreel alayhi salam to come, or the Prophet sallam giving a khutbah, and so it's part of his sunnah. It is on this journey. Because the greatest lesson of the Isra and Mi'raj that we've already mentioned, but what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to take back with him, just as me and you need to take this lesson as well, is that this night journey is a once in a lifetime event. It's not something which is going to occur every night or every month or every Ramadan or every few years. It is once in a lifetime. That iman boost, that spirituality, that meeting of the prophets and leading them in salah, going to Aqsa, this miraculous journey, it is once in a lifetime. But what Allah Azza wa Jal gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on that night is how to continue that same connection without that journey. not only for him, but for every single one of us. So we know when we stand in salah, we speak directly to Allah Azza wa Jal. It is a conversation that you have. And our Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ السَّاجِدُ. The closest place that you can be to Allah in this world is when you're making prostration. When you're at your lowest point on the earth, that is the closest place to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is what Allah Azza wa Jal wants from you. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have many challenges to face for the rest of his life. This wasn't the end, it was the beginning. Many more things would happen. Many of his close friends and companions and family members would die. Many of his children died alayhi salatu wasalam, as we know. He would have challenge upon challenge and hardship upon hardship, not only him, but all of his companions radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. So they needed something. And that is why salah is so amazing. It is that connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at any time that you want. So what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? He returned to earth and he came back to Mecca. And from that point onwards, whenever there was a difficulty facing him, whenever there was a hardship, what do we know from the sunnah? What would he ask Bilal to do? Go and make the adhan. He would go and hurry and rush and hasten to the prayer, because he understood that lesson. And the Prophet ﷺ took that lesson with him and he applied it and he embodied it and he lived it for the rest of his life until his death, alayhi salatu wasalam. But the problem is with us, that we also need to take that lesson and embody it. We also need to apply it. Because frankly, and I speak for myself as well, I'm included in this, none of us, when we have our difficulties and problems, none of us hasten to the salah first and then think about everything else. Rather, we will probably do everything else and exhaust every channel, and then when there's nothing left, oh, let's go and pray two rak'ahs as well. It is that mindset that needs to be changed. And so this is what the Isra al Mi'raj was about. It is a miraculous journey where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is told that Allah Azza wa Jal is always with the mu'mineen. Allah is always with the believers. And Allah's divine care and protection with His ultimate knowledge and perfect wisdom, it is always for the mu'mineen, the believers. But it is for us to have that strength of iman, that yaqeen and certainty, that we would turn to Allah even in the most difficult of situations. And yes, even when things are easy and things are going very well for us. And so with that lesson, this month of Ramadan, one of the things that we really need to do is develop that spiritual connection with Allah Azza wa Jal, primarily through the salah. Spend some time focusing on your salah, how you pray it, what time you pray, do you pray it on time, learning what it means, connecting with it. And I know it is difficult because Musa alayhi salam told us that it would be difficult. He knew that it would be difficult. But that is where the reward is, and that's why it is very difficult to attain that benefit of salah, because if it was easy, everyone would have it. It is something that you have to struggle and strive to do. But inshallah, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with His blessings in this month of Ramadan, we will strive and aim to do that, to spend a few minutes extra where we're not just rushing and praying because it's another thing that we have to tick off the checklist, but it's something that we actually want to do and enjoy doing and come closer to Allah Azza wa Jal through it. And with that and through that type of salah, you will find the benefits that Allah Azza wa Jal promised in the Quran and that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about in the sunnah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal that He gives us that ability to be from the people of salah, to understand it and embody it and apply it. And finally, I remind you of the dua of our Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, who this amazing, illustrious Prophet of Allah, who is linked to both of these holy places. It is probably a dua that all of you have memorized, that Allah mentions in Surah Ibrahim. One of the things that he asks for from Allah, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي. Oh Allah, make me from those people who preserve the prayer. A Prophet of Allah, who's promised Jannah, who is one of the mightiest, greatest messengers ever sent by Allah, has this humble dua. Oh Allah, make me from the people of prayer, وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي, and also from my children and my offspring, make them from the people of salah. And I think that's something that we need to make dua for more than Ibrahim alayhi salam, and that our children and grandchildren need more than the children of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Wallahu a'lam, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.